Everybody, to the Board of Selectmen's meeting on December the 15th, 2015. As we do each meeting, we want to remind everybody that the meeting is being recorded. And as we also do each meeting, we want to take a moment of silence and appreciation for our brave servicemen and women that are serving around the world, especially those in trouble areas in the Middle East. Thank you. We have on our agenda an appointment, our town planner, Sarah Raposa. And then we will have town administrator Mike Sullivan dealing with the health and insurance budget, and then our old and new business. Sarah's going to look at some of the planning board and ZBA budgets. But beforehand, we had just some concerns of the current zoning, especially in the downtown area, in the area of Pleasant Street, South Street, Oak Street, where we're beginning to see a large number. I'm sure there's a proper name for it, but I'm calling them double houses, where you have one house and then there's a small connector, be it a garage or a breezeway, and then you have another house that's being built. And I think the question was, is this what the residents of Medfield, you know, want for zoning? And I know a couple of years back, the planning board did go to a town meeting and try to amend that in some form, and actually was defeated at town meeting. And I spoke to a couple of members on the planning board, and they said, you know, well, if it appears that, you know, residents of Medfield are supportive of changing the zoning, you know, we might be able to, you know, be willing to relook at that, but we want to know that there's support for the community, and that maybe there's a change that people don't want this type of zoning. So that was the reason we wanted you maybe just to discuss with us what would have to take place for a zoning change and some thoughts on that. So thank you for coming in on that.
You're welcome. I've watched the video on Medfield TV YouTube channel about your discussion and sort of analysis of issue from your last meeting. So I think that you very much understand what the issue is, that two-family homes, duplexes, are allowed by right in the RU zoning district, which is the zoning district around downtown. Mm-hmm. It goes south of 109 to about Curve Street, and then north of 109 to about Green Street. So a property needs to be at least 20,000 square feet for a duplex and with 100 feet of frontage. And there are a couple other bits of dimensional requirements, but those are the basic ones. And those are the ones that we can actually track in our town's assessing database. So if people are curious about what they have and what their neighbors have, they can actually log on to the town's website, go to the assessor's database, and use that to identify their own lot size and frontage. Frontage might actually only be available on the tax maps, on the hard maps, but it is available, yeah. So you can sort of spy on what your neighbors have as well. So you can get a sense of your surroundings. The planning board and ZBA held several joint working sessions in 2014 to identify common issues, establish priorities, and this issue doesn't have a real name, duplexes, houses behind the houses, because what you may have considered to be a duplex really changes when you see basically two single-family homes with a common garage, in the double two-car garage, that sort of thing. It is definitely different, changes the character of the neighborhood, and it changes the affordability of the neighborhood as well. The boards kind of brainstormed, threw out a couple of suggestions on ways to mitigate through zoning amendments, increased buffers to adjacent properties, having a certain minimum percentage for commonwealths between the livable portion of the dwellings, equal amounts of outdoor space, and decreasing the floor area ratio. The floor area ratio is actually really high. It's not going to be the limiting factor really on any property in Medfield. But we have other lot coverage requirements, and the lot coverages in most of the downtown are actually reduced again by aquifer protection districts. So it's even smaller than what's in the dimensional table, for what it's worth. Cynthia Green and I have talked about this issue for some time, and she did some great initial research on the lot sizes in the RU, and then we just exchanged numbers again before the meeting. There's approximately 40 lots in the RU district that meet the basic criteria of the 20,000 square foot lot size with 100 feet of frontage. And about half are south of 109 and half north of 109. And it's possible that there are more lots within that 40 that could be eliminated based on the additional dimensional requirements. Perfect square, lot width, lot depth, could eliminate lots that have just the minimum, 100 feet of frontage. I mentioned what the potential strategies were, but the boards also talked about what that would mean for lot owners who kind of know what they have and maybe counting on it, and if restrictions might be more punitive than preventative in the long run, given the numbers that are left. So I don't have any necessarily policy recommendations on what to do about it, but if there are more people who are concerned about this and would like to talk about potential strategies that may have some traction to garner 2/3 vote at town meeting, then the planning board is certainly willing to consider it.
What's the best avenue then? I have a couple of emails, and I think there's some people here that might want to comment on their views on that, which we'll do momentarily. But what would the proper avenue be for those that were concerned about this? Would it be to go to the planning board meeting at some point that it was on the agenda?
Probably filter it through me so I could consolidate the concerns and actually have an agenda item for the planning board. Usually their meetings are pretty full, that we don't have, you know, open periods for discussion.
But I think there is support out there and concern to bring this back up again. Let me just read two emails I have from people that were unable to make the meeting, and then if there's any residents here that would also like to comment on that, we'll give you some time to do that as well. So Sarah can take some of this information back to the planning board and let them know if there is support in the town to do something with the zoning to change. For example, in the area of 79 South Street, you have 5 houses on 3 lots in that one area. But here's, this was from Patty Allen, who lives on South Street. She says, "I'm not sure if I'm concerned or just plain interested in why we are seeing so many of these double houses recently. I heard rumors that our neighborhood is over a water table that is partially replenished through water seeping back in from our yards. I would assume that reducing the area through hardtop, having 2 driveways instead of 1, and sheer square footage of a double house could be a future issue. I'm also interested in the increased traffic impact, the number of cars from the 1 smallish house to the 2 large houses, the change in the architectural character of the neighborhood, and the permanent removal of what I assumed would be less expensive, normal, middle-class homes in favor of large houses." And another one from Nicole and Tyler Tessier on Pleasant Street. They say, "My husband and I moved to Medfield 4 years ago to start a family, establish roots in one of the best towns in the state. The transition from city to suburb was much easier for us, as we were lucky enough to move downtown, i.e. Pleasant Street. We were able to walk to the center of town and enjoy all it has to offer. We choose Medfield for the same reasons that many of us do: excellent schools, safe neighborhood, green space. Over the past 3 years, we've watched multiple plots of land be converted from one lot to two, huge houses being built on land that was not large enough to accommodate such homes. We're seeing the quote-unquote space that we moved here for slowly shrink over time. We don't want to be in living in an area with large houses, no yards. If we would have, we would have moved to Needham. I'm writing to you in support of changing our zoning laws. Please help us update the laws so that those houses in our neighborhood stay as single houses on single plots of land, not two, three houses on single plots. Unfortunately, we cannot attend, but please voice our concerns. Is there anyone else here that has any opinions on the zoning that would like to speak? We're going to ask that you use the microphone so that the people on Medfield TV that are listening can hear you. And just identify yourself, if you would. Yes, sir.
Sure. I'm Nick Ionon. I'm at 70 Pleasant Street. The Tessiers are my immediate neighbors. I echo everything they said in that. Now, I have a question. I remember going to the town meeting when this was voted on last, and I think that vote probably predates a lot of the, you know, demolition and rebuild of the two families, or whatever you want to call them. Can you just remind me when that was voted on last?
I don't know off the top of my head.
I guess about 5-6 years ago.
Yeah, it definitely predates the activity in the neighborhood, because I remember being at that town meeting. But, you know, now people, if you look at what's being built, I grew up in a two-family. My grandparents lived upstairs. It was a way for a person to be able to subsidize their mortgage. But, you know, now it's, like I said, it's 2,000-3,000 square foot homes on one lot. And you look what used to be wooded private backyards, and you're seeing roof lines and houses that are dwarfing the original structure that aesthetically don't work. Traffic, we all know that Oak Street, Pleasant Street are narrow streets that are used as a cut through, and adding more and more multiple family residences to the neighborhood. I mean, you go Pleasant Street and Oak Street in the morning, and my kids can't even cross the four-way intersection at a four-way stop sign. People don't even let them cross to go to school, and they walk to the middle school and the high school. So, I mean, I echo everything the Tessiers say, and that you know, the green space is shrinking, and, you know, houses that don't fit packed behind one another are definitely changing the character, aesthetically, traffic, noise in the neighborhood.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Ralph Tell, 67 Pleasant Street, and I would like to echo everything that my neighbor Nick has said. I'm not opposed to two-family houses in the neighborhood. I just wanted to make that point. What I am opposed to is the poor design. We've seen designs where they're just shoehorning in these structures into small lots, and it is aesthetically not working out. And I think the town will ultimately suffer if that continues to be the trend.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else that wants to speak on that?
Hi, my name is Heather Gordon, Newport Lane. I do agree with, I think it wrecks the character of the center of town and some of the surrounding streets, where we don't have one house equals one lot. It just seems that the builders or developers are trying to jam in, you know, two or three for their profit motive into one lot. And I really think it takes away from the character of the center of the town. Additionally, they recently tore down that house, the little antique house next to the post office. And that was a little gem, and that should have stayed, and more should have been done for that. I really think we need to pay attention to the cross section of town going through South Street all the way down to North Street, and the surrounding streets, and try to keep one lot to one house.
Thank you. Anyone else that wants to speak on that? Yes, sir.
Hi, Andrew Wong from 8 Oak Street. And I would concur with some of the prior speakers that every time there's a house that goes up for sale in that area, it's typically bought by a builder. And the question not really is, you know, what does the community or the neighborhood want, but what's the biggest house I could possibly put on this lot? What will the zoning laws allow me? How big can I possibly go with the thinnest of curtilage around the actual structure? And these were, they're originally lots that were intended, that were built for single-family homes with a nice size lot. And now, well, can I squeeze, turn this single-family unit or home into a condominium, which is pretty much what they're building. They're building two-family condominiums. And, you know, is it just a matter of time before eventually most of the homes in the neighborhood turn over through people just moving on or moving to other areas, and a builder or a contractor is waiting in the wings to buy that house and tear it down, and what's the largest construction that I can put on this lot? That's what I'll take. That's what I'll build, and how high can I go? How high can I go? You know, and that's what it seems to be happening in almost every single one of these lots. So I certainly have my concerns, and I think my wife does too.
Thank you. Anyone else would like to speak?
Sure. Cynthia Green, 44 Pleasant Street. The house next to us went that way, and it went from a house that was around 2,000 square feet to 5,100, the two houses together. I'm also on the bylaw committee, and one of the things that I see as a real problem is we don't have a definition of a two-family in town. I owned a two-family in Somerville. It was one on top of the other, and I agree. I don't have a problem with two families. What was next to me was a two-family, but it was not the size. So the size is really a problem, and we do need to decide what is a two-family. To my mind, what's next to me is two homes stuck onto each other. It's not a two-family at all. It just has one common wall. And I would echo most of the comments that have already been made. I'm concerned about water in the neighborhood, because in 2010, we had flooding on Pleasant Street and a lot of South Street as well, homes that had never flooded. And I just worry that with more of the area being covered with homes as well as these driveways, that we're going to have more flooding of the neighborhood. And I think we also have to think about the property values for the people who are already living there. I've already been told by a real estate agent that my property value has gone down because of what went in next to me. And typically when you have a new home put in next to you, your property value goes up. So I think there's a lot of problems, and we need to look at the zoning and see what we can do.
Thank you. Anyone else that would like to speak on that? Sorry, I think you're certainly hearing the folks here that there's some concern on that of looking for ways to change that. So, again, getting back to me, my first question, for these folks here and others, what's the best avenue to get to the planning board to see if something could be brought before town meeting to make some changes, as they've suggested?
Well, I'll bring the concerns to the planning board. I don't have an answer for you right now what the course of action will be. I don't anticipate anything being proposed at this year's town meeting, though. It's too late in our cycle to start from scratch to be able to make it.
Mm-hmm. At least have the conversation going. Anyway.
What would it take? You have to figure out what exactly, what changes you want, what amendments you want, how you're going to change the zoning. So that's going to take some time to figure out exactly would this look
like. Yeah, 48 Section 6 outlines the process in getting to town meeting with zoning amendments. And one of the biggest issues for the planning board is actually the planning board's public hearing. Yeah. So you need to draft your article, make sure it's public hearing ready, and then it's a month lead time just advertising to get to your public hearing, and usually there's one or two, so you can present it and then have enough time to get comments, and then doing all that before the language needs to be ready to be printed in the warrant, and it moves really fast, as you know. So to get started on something that may get proper traction, you know, get started after the holidays. We only have one planning board meeting in January, one in February due to the holidays. So you know, unless we amended our schedule, it would be very tough.
Well, I think it seems like it's a very deliberative process, rightly so, because it's a big deal. I mean, whenever you change zoning laws or anything, it affects people's the value of their property. Mm-hmm. Could be positively or negatively, depending on how they. So I can see why it's more of a measured approach to make sure that it's not done hastily.
Yes. The planning board has had a couple of discussions so far this fall and even as recently as our last meeting last week about zoning amendments.
Yep.
And the temperature of the board was really kind of deferential to the planning up at the state hospital and kind of keeping zoning amendments kind of light so as not to dilute or confuse residents with too much happening at once. And that's maybe dependent on the time frame of the planning committee. So it may not be as concurrent as they were thinking 2 months ago.
We see either Peter, Mark, comments.
Well, I guess I thought it is something that is on a policy level that the town really should be looking at, that and the 6,000 square foot of additional land that in the RU gets you an extra unit. So that as a result of that low threshold for each extra unit, we get the development on North Street and that we have and the development on Brook Street that we have.
And the development on Spring Street that we have. They were all.
Yes.
So, you know, when we talk about possibly using housing as an economic development tool, this zoning is what makes that permissible by right. So, you know, we certainly can look at it from different perspectives.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because what I hear from comments is that people don't mind two-family houses. It's how they look. And I agree that that these houses that are almost connected by a single 2x4 just don't have much interest. They don't really look very nice. So I guess maybe that would be something where some sort of design review might provide some benefit for making them look better.
So sure, design review can be legislated through zoning. But what are the regulations? And so, you know, all of those things require a lot of thought and
a lot of time, yeah.
Really. And whenever you legislate taste, that's really hard because not everybody agrees with my taste.
It's impossible through zoning, so.
Either Peter, Mark, anything else on that?
No, I think it's just a matter of it's going to take some time, but it would be good to get started and get it on the
I think it behooves the town to look at it and make a decision as to whether or not what we have is right and proper or whether we should be thinking of changing it, because it is going to change the downtown. If you're a builder, you're looking at these potentials as building lots basically, and so that if you can get a building lot for less because there are two units available there, then you're going to be keep building these connected houses.
Hi, Nick Iannone again, 70 Pleasant Street. I'm just curious what the normal lead time is to get it, because, you know, we watch these builders knock down a house in a day, and in less than 45, there's a brand new 3,000 square foot structure on the lot.
So, for example, the home at 67 South Street, that went before the planning board for site plan approval hearings over the summer. So the hearing notice is in the paper, and then it gets sent to abutters or abutters to abutters within 300 feet of the property. I recognize many of your faces from other properties, so you know that process. So it does start sooner than the home is actually knocked down. And some homes aren't knocked down, like the one at 67. But you mentioned 70 North Street, and that was knocked down, and that went through the Historical Commission.
There was a demolition delay. The developer just waited out.
And actually, it was released from demo delay early because the Historical Commission approved of the design that was.
Oh, the new structure. Oh, okay.
The new structure, yeah. So there are different processes with the Historical Commission.
Sir, which one is 67 South Street? Is that the one that they're just working on right now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the original home remains, and the new house, single-family house, is behind it, connected to garages.
That is a two-family.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one that we commented
that
on.
There's a colonial now behind it. There's a grant, I think Madam Grant owned the house, and now they've had a little part, and it's like a huge colonial now right behind it.
Yeah, I think that's the one that we commented on the parade day.
The lead time to get this to a vote at town meeting is, what, 6 months?
I like to start it early, just so we have, you know, the holidays to get through and knowing what to expect. I will bring it to the planning board at their January 4th meeting, these concerns, for discussions about what the next steps would be, but I can't speak for them tonight.
No, I understand. I'm just thinking in the back of my head that you know, if we're not getting on the 2016 town meeting, we look at 2017, of the 40 lots that you said are potential, how many of those are going to be gobbled up, and whether they're knocked down or you got a 2,000 square foot cape on the front and a 4,000 square foot colonial parked behind it are going to happen in a year. So I just, you know, is it impossible to get on this year's warrant? It is.
I'm not going to say it's impossible, but I am leaving that decision to the board members.
Okay.
My suggestion might be, because they're the ones that are going to make that decision, my suggestion would be to contact the planning board members, go to the planning board meeting, you can get on the agenda. Is there an open...
I can't speak to the agenda right now.
No, but I'm just wondering if somebody wanted... to get on the agenda of the planning board, what's the proper route? They'd go through you?
Through me, yes.
But you may want to call individual planning board members, yourself, on that. The other thing is, as a neighborhood, when these individual houses do go on, they do have to have a hearing. There are notices that it's important that people contact each other, let them know, and go to those hearings and make your voices be heard at those.
You may have an impact on design, but at this point, it's a by right. Requiring the planning board can't necessarily say no because of its use in the zoning table.
If you're concerned enough, I would suggest, too, that you go to get in touch with the planning board and try to get on the January hearing.
I mean, it doesn't happen a lot, but you have other options. A special town meeting could be called. You have to gather how many signatures?
To call a special town meeting is 200 signatures, and to put an article on the special is 100 signatures.
Depending upon what goes on at Medfield State Hospital, there might be a special town meeting with that, but that I can't tell you there is or there isn't, but you could, which is hard to do, and the town kind of shies against that, but I mean, that's an option.
I have one more question. I don't know if Ann Thompson still owns that home or if she sold her home, but is the home with
sold.
The bond? It has been sold. So on that potential lot, that looks like a sizable rectangular lot. Could more than one house be put on that, or could
no,
they potentially?
Many. When properties come on the market, I get a lot of calls asking about whether it's possible. If I can't remember the exact reason why it's not possible, it might be just shy of frontage or just a little bit shy in land area. It's not possible.
Yeah, I think that lot is not as big as you think it is. The land at the rear goes with another house lot. It doesn't go with the Thompson's house. So there's
the
only...
The house is right next to the school, and I don't think we need dense housing.
Well, like I said, too, if you're curious about any properties, just use the town's assessing website. There's a great new mapping system that's there, and you can plug in addresses. You can look people up by their last names, and you can see what the lot sizes are there. In the zoning.
No, I have been on that site. Thank you.
Okay. Again, my suggestion would be that you organize each other, keep this on the front burner so it's not going to go away. You do have some options for this year, or as Sarah pointed out, there is a process. They have to have public hearings and they have to advertise, and it does take time, you know, to do a lot of that as well. But I know if I was that, I'm very concerned about that particular area of town. It's the village part of Medfield. To me, it's one of the most special parts of town, from Metacomet to Oak to Pleasant to South, and it's changing, and you don't, in my opinion, you don't want to see that change, so you're going to lose that special quality that is that village part of Medfield that's there. So I think it would be up to you guys and others to keep that on the front burner and bring that to the town and state your case, and hopefully what those changes would be, whether they were amendments or you're going to have to work out what's the alternative.
Mr. Chairman,
yes,
the other thing to keep in mind is zoning changes are particularly difficult because they require a two-thirds vote. So it's you really have to go out there and beat the bush and drum up your support if you want to get a zoning change through. At town meeting, yeah.
One of the things that I've thought about is that density in and of itself, I guess, doesn't bother me. It's what the density looks like. I happen to love the look of Prentice Place. I think it looks wonderful, and I wouldn't mind. And I happen to like the look of Old Village Square. I don't like the look of some of the other denser developments in the downtown. Again, it's just a taste thing. And so that, for me, that I kind of tilt towards a design review process where people that have more expertise in architectural design could have some input into the process that would get a better result. When I was on the ZBA, I sat on the 55 and over development that's between the town garage and the railroad tracks and Dale Street. And I kept thinking, well, gee, this is kind of dense, but, you know, it's the same density, basically, as Prentice Place. And I had great hopes for it. But to me, it came out looking like just kind of I don't like the looks of it at all. Whereas Prentice Place, on the other hand, I think is great looking. So I don't know. It's just I guess I came to the result in my own mind that it's not the density. It's what the places look like. And I don't know how you deal with that other than design review.
Okay, thank you so much for coming out. I think you sent a message very clear to Sarah. We'll bring that back to the planning board. And thank you. And Sarah, the other part of
budgets.
Yeah, big budgets. The only thing I didn't give to Evelyn earlier were my goals, year 2 of 5. So there's copies for you and Mike. So I'm requesting through the planning board and ZBA level funded budgets.
And there's really not much there. I mean, it's basically you.
Mm-hmm. Planning board is my salary and some operating expenses.
Yeah.
And ZBA is operating expenses. We're generally good for a little bit of a return at the end of the year, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you want to be able to look these over as far as the goals?
And, yeah, definitely, yeah. I think that would be good.
Kind of comment on those. Thank you for doing that, Sarah.
You're welcome. It's nothing new. It's just an update from last year's.
Okay. Off the grill on these level budgets, see what you can't cut everything by
20% off. Keep going up.
Any comments on the budget? Any other comments on the budget?
I would just mention to people at home that don't have the papers in front of them, the ZBA budget is $5,000 and the planning budget is just under $92,000.
Okay, Sarah, thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Next we have Town Administrator Mike Sullivan. There were some issues raised on the FY17 health and insurance budget. Mike, you want to comment on that?
The FY16 budget for health and life insurance is $3,916,217. Mm-hmm. The vast majority of that, all except about $12,000, is for health insurance, mm-hmm. and there's just a little under $12,000 for life insurance. The request for 2017 is actually the life insurance has dropped slightly, and the health insurance is up about $150,000. So it's a 3.75% increase. When I did the budget estimate, I estimated a 7% increase, I believe it was. And the rates are estimated to go up 7%. So you might ask why, when the rates are going up 7%, is the budget only going up 3.75%? It seems to me the big factor keeping the budgets down under the 7% increase is there was a state law passed several years ago that any retiree who is eligible on their own or through a spouse for Medicare must transfer to a Medicare plan. And then the town provides 50% of the cost of the Medicare supplemental plan premium. Several years ago, there was a lot of retirees, early retirees, who, when they retired, were not 65, were not eligible to enroll in Medicare. Now, as they're starting to turn 65, they are required to go into a Medicare plan, and that creates substantial savings for the town on that those individuals' plan. That will go on for a while. Eventually, it will catch up, and it will become a routine thing. But for a couple of years, it is helping to keep the health insurance budget down a bit. There are some other factors coming in, though, that I think are going to push this budget up in the next few years. One of the things that the Insurance Advisory Committee has been looking at is the potential impact of the Affordable Care Act. That's the federal program that most people refer to as Obamacare. And they've been wrestling with that for a few months now. And there is $7,500 included in this budget to provide for the reporting requirements that are going to take effect under the Affordable Care Act starting next year, which is only 3 weeks away. For calendar year 2015, we have to report to the IRS the health insurance coverages or lack of coverage for every employee who is considered a full-time regular employee. And full-time regular employee is defined as an employee who works more than 30 hours a week on a regular basis. Now, under the state mandatory health insurance coverage, we only have to report on employees who are subscribing to one of our health insurance plans. Under the Affordable Care Act, we have to report on every regular employee who works 30 hours a week, whether or not they have insurance with the town. And we have to report on their spouses and dependents. It's going to involve a lot of things, including eventually collection of Social Security numbers. We have to find out how many dependents people who don't enroll in the health insurance plan have. We have the dependents for people who enroll in our health insurance family plans, but we don't have the dependents, for example, for people who don't enroll in health insurance. We're going to have to collect that. And in the past, we've relied on our health insurance carriers to provide those reports for the state tax requirements. Now, our health insurance carriers don't have information, obviously, on people who don't enroll in health insurance, because there'd be no need for them to have them. So we have to go, in addition to our health insurance carriers, we have to go to our payroll providers. We have ADP, we happen to have ADP as our payroll firm, and they at first refused to do it. They said they weren't going to provide that information, but so many of their clients are insisting that they need their help, that they are trying to come up with a program that will report the information that the IRS is requiring. But they have to create special software for that, and there's a cost to it. So I put in $7,500. It's just a guesstimate. I don't know what it will be. I know Chris has been working with Georgia and Joy the health insurance carriers trying to come up with a way to provide that information. But it's very complicated. And there are penalties. There are severe penalties. For example, the Cadillac tax, which you probably heard about, that takes effect in 2018, we did a rough calculation. Our potential annual liability, if we are over the Cadillac tax limits are $450,000 a year penalty, paid by the town, not by the employees, by the town. One of the reasons the Northeast in particular is susceptible to that is when the Affordable Care Act was written, they applied the same levels of determining what the Cadillac tax was across the entire country. So Massachusetts, where you have a much higher level of health care, is evaluated for Cadillac tax determination, the same level as in Alabama or Mississippi, where your health care standards are much lower. And your health...
The cost of Massachusetts versus Mississippi.
Right.
Yes.
It's the same cost for the whole country.
Yes. So if a family plan in Massachusetts costs $2,500 and a family plan in Alabama costs $1,000, they use the same total amount to determine whether your plans exceed the Cadillac levels.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're going to find an awful lot of employers in the East Coast and West Coast areas where healthcare tends to be more expensive are going to be potentially subject to huge, huge fines unless they scale back their insurance plans. And when they establish the Cadillac tax, it's not just on what the employee pays. It's the total combination of what the employee pays and what the employer pays. So it's very easy to go over it. And basically what it means is we can't afford $450,000 annual penalty. So it means the plans are going to have to be scaled back. You're going to have to increase your deductibles or co-pays or cut back on the type of plans. So ultimately, the employee suffers.
Yeah, their plans aren't going to be as good as what you would be willing the town
to pay
to provide them
if you weren't going to be fined.
Exactly. Yeah.
And the money is going, the fine goes to the federal government. So they're going to use it to cover their expenses. And that's only one of the problems. There's another problem that if you have to offer a plan that covers that your employee, what they determine to be an affordable plan, and that means it cannot exceed 9.5%. The premium that the employee is required to pay cannot exceed 9.5% of their salary. The school department estimated they have somewhere like 60 positions that could be susceptible to that. And my understanding, it is very confusing at this point, I'm not sure I understand it myself, but I was told that if you have a complaint filed against you for not providing an affordable plan, and it's you ruled, the determination is made that you don't have an affordable plan, the fine is to the employer is $2,000. But it's not $2,000 for the employer who they make the finding against. It's $2,000 for every employee you have who works 30 hours a week on a regular basis. So if you had one person that you had a ruling against, you could potentially be fined hundreds of thousands of dollars. Again, that would go to the federal government. So this seems like it's a tax program on employers to fund the federal government. And is it going to be that the people who are paying for health insurance coverage are going to lose their benefits to provide coverage for people who pay nothing for health insurance coverage? I don't know. But in any event, those are problems down the road. But for now, we're looking at a 3.75% increase. But keep in mind, it's $4,062,000. So it's over $4 million we're looking at for health insurance. Now, our total town budget is around $60 million. So you're talking 7 or 8% of your total budget is now just for health insurance. And the other thing we were told when we met with our insurance carriers, they were saying that the increase the trend increase in healthcare cost is between 5.5% and 6%. So they said that the you should expect at least a 5 to 6% increase in your rates this year. And one of the main reasons is the cost of pharmaceuticals. You know, you have prescription drugs that can cost $100,000 a year for a patient. Now, some of them are miracle drugs. Some of them, I think, is because the federal government is in cahoots with the pharmaceuticals. I understand that Medicare, when the Affordable Care Act was written, there was a provision in there that the insurance companies, that the Medicare program cannot question the cost of prescription drugs. They must pay whatever the manufacturer asks. Non-negotiable. Non-negotiable, right. So to me, that is highway robbery that is condoned by our Congress and our president or whatever, the whole kit and caboodle in Washington. So I think the public better wake up to this because, you know, all the goodies were passed out at the beginning. You know, you got health care coverage for students until they're 26 years old or non-students, I think, anyway. You got, you know, they lowered the Medicare premiums the first year the Affordable Care Act passed. Now they're starting to go up 15% a year because the election is over. For example, the Cadillac tax doesn't kick in until 2018 when the next election is over. So these guys are playing games at the expense of the American taxpayers, and it's going to come home to roost. And we're seeing it in what's happening to these health insurance budgets, and it's only going to get worse. And I understand there's something like 56,000 pages of regulations for the Affordable Health Care Act. Now, who possibly can tell you what's in that if you got 56,000 pages? I remember when the former Speaker of the House made the comment, well, we have to pass it so we can find out what's in it. And I think they're still finding out what's in it. I understand there's a need for health care, but my God, you know, pass something that at least people can understand and that at least is fair. But, our claims experience, on the other hand, is very good this year. Where our claims, total claims went down. We are in very good shape to be at the bottom of the range of increases, which will be announced at the MMA meeting that I believe you're going to go to. But even the bottom of the range, the suggestion is it might be a minimum of a 5 to 6% increase, even if you have good experience, just because of trending costs. So it's a scary thing. The other thing on this, we have that unfunded liability for the OPEB. We set up an OPEB trust. You voted to establish it a couple of months ago. We're having our first meeting Thursday morning at 10:30, if any of you are around and you care to attend.
Who's on that?
It's going to be Gus Murphy, yeah. Peter Moran, yeah. Georgia Joy, and myself.
Okay. Yeah.
So a good committee. And we have about $1.5 million set aside.
Good.
We've been putting last couple of years $400,000 a year adding to that. So, yeah.
It's a very good start.
Unfortunately, under the private accounting regulations, I believe starting fiscal 17, you're going to have to record your entire unfunded liability on your books,
mm-hmm.
which I read one article that said that probably 70% of American cities will have a negative net worth once they record those,
okay.
because you've got to record your pension, unfunded pension liabilities.
Yeah.
You know, we're a small town. We have about $60 million in unfunded pension and health insurance liabilities.
Not only small towns and cities, but look at the states.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some of the states were in trouble before that, you know, Illinois and New Jersey, some of these states, but.
Okay. Well, thank you, Michael, on
yep.
that. Under O Business, we have to review the selectman calendar and any discussions for the next meeting we have for January 5, budget review, permanent planning, building committee update on the public safety building, and articles that require legal review would be taking place.
I was going to make one suggestion, if it's possible. I don't know what it is. I don't know. I believe I sent you a copy of the governor's proposed legislation to assist cities and towns, and there were a lot of good things in there. I've got to give the governor credit. He, I think he really listened to what city and town officials were saying. I have heard there are already objections to it. You know, I'm sure the lobbyists are flooding the State House trying to block some of the provisions. I think it would be good to try to get our legislators in before, or, you know, before they really get into the nitty-gritty of the debate, to try to encourage them to stick with the governor's proposal as much as possible and try to get those provisions attached.
Do you want to try to get them in then?
I'd try to like to try to get them in, if you like, move it up if we can, yeah. Yeah.
I noticed one of the things was the double polls to put the...
The double poll provision, yes.
You're supposed to be moved within 90 days, but there's no fee. Sure. The governor had recommended a fee, which certainly makes sense.
Yes. The other provision, one I think would save us a lot of money, is the ability to advertise electronically and rather than put it in newspapers. But understand that has been attempted before, and the newspapers publishers blocked it.
Do you have a ballpark of what we're spending to advertise?
I probably could get that from Joy. They could do a, or Matt could do a vendor report.
We've tried to cut down as much advertising, only what we absolutely have to advertise by law, because it is so expensive.
But if you could do this electronically, you're going to save.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to rescind all the traffic rules and orders because they've been adopted sort of piecemeal over the years. And we had a college student a few years ago that mapped out all of our traffic rules and orders and put them on a disc so we can show them on a, you know, where your stop signs are, where your yield signs are, what your speed limits are, all of those things. And I thought if we could rescind all of those and revote them as one package, it would be great. And when we looked at it, we thought it would cost us around $10,000 for the advertisement. If we could do that electronically, it's $10,000 you'd save right there.
Yeah.
And, you know, by the time you talk about all those bids, Ken Feeney's always coming into you with asphalt bids and material bids. You've got all the chemical bids for the treatment plant. You'd save thousands of dollars just on that provision alone. And there are all kinds of things in there that would help cities and towns, but they're going to be opposed. A lot of them are going to be fought.
I'm sure the lobbyists would be out at full speed.
Yep.
So can we add then to the January our two state reps and state senator?
If they can make it, that'd be good.
Okay. That, of course, is subject to their availability,
Anything else on the additions to?
No.
Okay. Thanks, Mike. We also have a vote to approve the minutes of November 24th. Any corrections or changes?
So moved. Second.
All in favor?
Yep.
We have under licenses and permits the, this is a new one, the Zulu Gallery.
Yeah.
Would like
a
one-day, he does such a good job over there, a one-day wine and malt beer permit for First Thursdays beginning January 7th and running through June the 2nd, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Questions, debate, all those in favor?
Aye. Yep.
Under new business, we have a request to vote to support the Mosquito Control Board FY17 funding. Mike, you want to comment on that?
This letter comes out. They've been sending it out for the past two or three years. The Mosquito Control Board budget has to be approved as a state, I believe the State Reclamation Board. And they ask all of the cities and towns that are members of each mosquito control district to vote to support the budget increase over the prior year. And it's up, I think, about $4,000 or $5,000. It's about, what, $63,000, something it was, Medfield share. And I think they do a tremendous job. It has gone up quite a bit, but between equine encephalitis and Nile virus and all the other diseases that are prevalent, I think it's something that we need to support. So I'd recommend that you support the new budget request.
So moved.
Second.
Questions or debate? Hearing none, vote on the motion. All those in favor?
Yep.
And
incidentally, that amount is part of our cherry sheet assessment.
Okay.
On the cherry sheet. Yes. And the other thing that people should be aware of, a lot of people think because it's Norfolk County Mosquito Control, it's part of Norfolk County. It is not. It is a separate entity. So.
Okay. We have selectmen are invited to attend Eagle Court of Honor for Mark Lavallee on Saturday, January the 16th at the center in Medfield. Again, it's just so impressive the number of Eagle Scouts we continue to see here in Medfield. We have a vote to award a 3-year contract for the single stream recycling to E.L. Harvey and Sons, as recommended by the Transfer Station and Recycling Committee.
Yeah, they met this week. We received 4 proposals. We solicited, I believe, 6 firms. Mm-hmm. One was not interested, Miller Recycling out of Mansfield. Mm-hmm. We didn't receive any response from Waste Management. We got prices from Casella, Republic, and Harvey. I guess that was it. There were 3 responses, so it was 5 total. We contacted and got 3 proposals. Harvey was by far the best price-wise. It will be about a $10,000 to $12,000 increase in the cost of recycling. Mm-hmm. Right now, we're paying $10 per ton tipping fee for waste, mm-hmm. and it's going to go to $20 next year, and then $22 in the second year of the contract, and $24 the third year. The transportation fee, because they pick up the loads and to take them to the Harvey facility in Westboro, I believe it is, that will go from $155 a trip to $160, and then to $165. So it will be, it's somewhere between a $10,000 and $12,000 increase. Mm-hmm. And the chart I provided you gives the breakdown of the cost. And of course, you have to estimate because you don't know how much you're going to collect. So we estimated on 1,000 tons a year of recycled materials, mm-hmm. With an average of 15 trucks a week at the prices they included. So
15 a week,
huh? 15 a month. About 15 a month, yeah.
That's pretty good. I mean, that's, yeah.
I mean, so that's, yes. And we still save a considerable, I think it's about $25, $30 a ton over taking it to the incinerator.
Yeah, exactly. Was Harvey, are they the ones that have it right now?
Yes, they do, yeah. We did have Casella. We used to have Casella, yeah, and then we switched to Harvey.
Yeah.
And we're sticking with Harvey.
You know, this is something, though, the average citizen, if they want, those that don't recycle, there is a way. The more you recycle, the more you can bring down your taxes.
Definitely.
Right.
You can save money by recycling. As you see, as Mike just stated, the increase that are going up, so the more we can recycle, the less that has to be shipped out of town, the more we, the taxpayers and the town, are going to save. And that's something the individual can do themselves to help lower their tax bills.
And I think generally people have been very cooperative. You know, they're very, I think since we put in the single stream recycling, people are very willing to use it. I think there's a certain stubborn group that thinks that they're not going to recycle, they don't care no matter what. I don't know whether it's laziness or hatred of government or what it is, but for some reason they think it's beneath them to recycle and they won't bother. But the vast majority of people, I think, are very good about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you know, you can always be better.
Yeah.
One of the things the committee's been talking about, and I laughed, I said sometimes I think I've been around too long. The thing that, one of the things they're looking at now is what I used to call garbage collection. We used to have when I first came here, but now it's called organic food waste recycling. Yes, but they're talking about actually supplying buckets to people that you would take to the transfer station and dump in a container, and it would be carted away. And
you know, what I thought struck me is amazing that, I believe I have the correct, that 25% of everything is garbage that's in there.
That's
very large.
Yeah,
so if you could remove that, I suppose you're saving.
Yeah, they say it's the third largest component of solid waste.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder if that's quite the case in Medfield, because I suspect a lot of people have garbage disposals, so their food waste isn't as great as you might think it would be. And I suspect, you know, I think the Medfield Green has been doing quite a program to encourage people to recycle, you know, vegetable and fruit through composting, and so that probably reduces somewhat. They have a waiting list. Yeah, they have a waiting list, so they're talking about getting more of them.
So that would be fun to try that as a pilot program for them to try that, to see how that goes. I'd be very curious. You know,
yes.
Some people will
train
themselves.
Apparently, they say that Sherbin does it now, and that you can go over there and take a look at it. And yeah. And the state is mandating it for restaurants that have over a certain, restaurants and hotels that have over a certain volume of garbage.
That's right, right?
Yeah. So
we also vote to recommend town council draft an agreement between the town and Open Space LLC for use of land owned opposite us on James Avenue for a municipal parking lot. And we're going to wait till the town council has that, correct?
He's drafting that. Yeah, we did talk to them, and they are going to put a stone wall in between the existing town parking lot and the new one they're putting in. They're going to have trees planted along that. I don't know if you've seen the progress to date, but they put the sidewalk in with the brick strip along it. They're going to have, and they have a little raised concrete area alongside of the building that they said they actually put in to prevent the sidewalk plows from damaging the windows. But they're going to put flower boxes on that platform during the non-snowy season, I guess. So, and then there was a light that we had left over from the, I think when they redid the library lights over there, one of those post lamps, and that is town property. So we said we'll put that on there, and it'll be a nice little feature. The trees, the stone wall, the planting boxes, and the light. So I think it'll be anything would have been improvement over what was there before. I mean, it was just a disaster. Yeah.
Okay, thank
Mike,
you.
How were the trees chosen?
How were the what?
How were the trees selected? What?
They haven't been yet. They haven't been. So the tree warden will work with them on that. But if you have any suggestions or ideas, I think
we just suggest you talk to somebody that knows something about it, like Mike Leaders or somebody that's an arborist.
Yeah, it will probably end up with some sort of a columnar tree because you want something that branches up because there's going to be a lot of plowing operations in there. So.
We can, that's a good suggestion. That maybe we can, Mike Leader usually, I don't want to speak for Mike Leader, but usually he's very good at, you know, helping with recommendations.
Yeah, he's been very good in the past.
With ideas for.
Okay. Let me just, we have under new business, I see Alex Stevens that's here. We have two issues that come up concerning bridges that go over Elm and Phillips Streets, and I know Alec, you were concerned and had some questions. Do you want to maybe just state what the concerns are?
Hello. It's an empty room today compared to what I'm used to.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming.
So I had written an email today to Richard and Mike, and also to Ken and Bobby Kennedy about the bridge. There's two bridges actually right in front of our house, mm-hmm. where the two outlets from Jules Pond go under the road. One of them is the wood deck bridge. That's the obvious one. There's another one that's less obvious, but the concern I had was about the wood deck bridge. I had emailed the same group earlier in the summer about the when heavy trucks drive over that bridge, which there are a lot of, you know, you get big dump trucks and landscaping trucks and trash collection trucks and, you know, building supply delivery trucks. Whenever a big truck like that goes over the bridge, the wood deck does a dipsy-do where it deflects an inch or two in the middle. So I had asked Ken to take a look at that, and he said he'd sent out an engineer. And then this past week, they had two different crews of DPW staff out there in the water under the bridge. And it sounded like their conclusion was that the way it's set up, I could have brought a drawing, I guess, but there's an old dry-laid stone, you know, masonry wall that must have, you know, dates back hundreds of years. And then the wood deck bridge actually spans beyond that wall and is resting on, it's actually not being supported by the stone wall, but the stone wall that's under there is collapsing into the stream. So part of what I think is happening is when the heavy vehicles go over that, they're sort of compressing the load-bearing soil, which is then wanting to squeeze inwards and then knock over the walls. But there's some real heavy stones, I would guess about 400 or 500 pound stones that have fallen out of the wall already into the stream. And then on the side that's closer to our house, closer to Foundry Street, the wall is out of plumb by about 18 inches to 2 feet, so it's, you know, it's ready to tumble itself into the stream. And I wasn't there when the crew was there on Friday, but what I heard was that they had determined that it was not safe for them to be working in there because they're standing in the cold water and in danger of having this stone wall tip over on them.
Alex, is that the bridge where Foundry Street takes off back to the dead end?
No, on the other side of the pond, where the waterfall is and the old turbine.
It's the one in front of Alex's house.
Yeah.
On Phillips?
Yeah, on Phillips Street.
Yeah.
The three things that I had written about today that Richard asked me to come in and speak to were, one is that if that other wall tips into the stream, the two consequences might be that the bridge is no longer sturdily enough, you know, supported sturdily enough. And the other would be that it's going to block the stream. So when we have heavy melt and runoff and big storms, and I open up the dam to keep the pond from overflowing, if that stream is blocked, it's going to make it difficult for me to do that. So the other thing is that we've been doing a little bit of work on that dam to try and shore up some of the undercut, you know, old, you know, 200-year-old stonework. So right now there's, and the highway guys appreciated this, there's very little water flowing through there right now. So if there's going to be more work happening, I wanted to know just so that we could coordinate.
Sure.
You know, if I start, you know, the work that we're doing is just about done. So if we start sending lots of water down there, but that gets in the way of what they're doing, I just wanted to coordinate that. And then the third thing would be if, you know, if it ends up being a case where the bridge needs to be major overhaul or replaced, that from a historical point of view, I would like to record a vote that it looks like it does now instead of, you know, yeah, a modern highway-looking bridge. Sure.
But the issue isn't the bridge, though. The bridge itself is okay. It's the under the old walls. Am I correct on that?
Well, I think there's two issues. One is that the bridge part, the wood deck of the bridge is pretty worn, and when a heavy truck goes over it, it deflects noticeably. I don't know if that's within its tolerance for deflection, or if that means that the boards are gonna snap and there's gonna be a truck in the water. But
Alex, is there a tonnage limit on that bridge?
There's not, and I asked Ken earlier in the summer to have his engineer make a recommendation for a weight restriction. I think the issue that, at least from a local traffic point of view, is that the Elm Street Bridge, where the guys apparently ran a lumber truck into a tree today, that has a 3-ton weight limit and also a limit in terms of the length of a vehicle that can easily fit through there because of the curve.
Yeah. Is that 3 tons or 8 tons?
That's three.
To follow up, a person wrote in on that. She said it was 8 ton, but you're saying it's three?
The sign says three.
Okay.
The sign on Elm Street says three. I'm sure whatever truck drove over it today was more than 3 tons from what I heard the neighbor who lives there describe it as. But So if there were a similar, so right now, the only way for a truck that's not going either on Route 109 or North Street or not North Street, Medfield, but North Street and Walpole over by Bubbling Brook, or Route 27 to get from Medfield to Walpole is to go by our house. So from a personal and, you know, selfish point of view, I'd love it if those trucks didn't go running by our house, but I understand that that's sort of the...
I've noticed over the years that there's been a drastic increase in the number of trucks, and I don't know if they're coming from Walpole, exactly where they're coming from.
They go by at all times of the day and night and crash into the trees and, you know.
There's a rock crushing operation up on West Mill Street. A lot of big trucks go there now.
Right.
Who oversees, is that the state that actually oversees all bridges?
All the bridges are town. The only bridges the state oversees now, well, for some reason they oversee the 109 bridge. Yeah. But then they oversee bridges that go over railroad tracks. Right. So they would oversee the Curve Street Bridge. But other than that, railroad grade crossings and all the bridges in town are the town's responsibility.
So that's under, that'd be under a DPW to?
Yeah.
Can we pull Ken in on that just to see? I don't know if he has had any ideas to look at that.
I know Roland Lavallee was out this week. Because we had to meet with them on the West Street Bridge. There's some issues there. So I thought Ken maybe was going to go down with them to see that site. So let me check with Ken and find out if he did.
And I think Alex makes a good, can we just make sure maybe Ken, when he's going to do that, just lets Alex know so that whatever he's doing with the pond, we can coordinate.
Sure,
so that,
yeah.
We're on the same page on that.
And try and keep their boots dry.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's, right, I mean, the three things, and this is similar to the beaver dam issue upstream, is that if there's a sudden flow of water and that is obstructed, it's going to be...
Yes.
It could be, it could be nothing, but it could be a problem, and then...
Did Mike Francis get a hold of you? Did they finish putting the second and third beaver? Were they able to get the third one in?
That's what he said. I haven't been to look, but he said they did.
Yeah, they were working on putting the second beaver deceiver in the main, and they were going to try to put a third one in under the second sluice.
Did they move them down also instead of having them just go over the top of the dam, Mike?
I think they were going to put them through the dam, but I haven't been up there. Yeah.
I was just wondering if they had.
I haven't looked, but I can go look.
Yeah.
The issue is the way they have that designed is that the height of the pipe over the dam is what sets the level of the pond.
Right.
So if it's down deep in the dam, then the pond will be much lower.
Alan, can we have you maybe coordinate with Mike and Ken so that we're on the same page as far as what's happening with the bridge? Would you be able?
We're not talking about beavers anymore.
No, I'm talking about the bridge.
Yeah. The bridge.
Okay. Coordinate with you, Mike, and
And Ken. Yeah. God, you're under assault from all sides there. So. The bridges on one side, the beavers on the other. Yes,
that's right. Yeah. Last time I got appointed to a beaver committee. Next time, yeah.
Yes.
Well, we have another one of your neighbors. Actually, a different bridge, but this is the one that goes over Elm Street that crosses over Millbrook, and this individual lives on Elm Street. And she says, "Can you please put a sign on the corner of Elm and Phillip, and then one at the Willock School saying no trucks," which can be attached to the, now she said 8-ton limit, but you're saying 3, that are posted there now. Today the bridge was closed because a huge truck couldn't make it over the bridge and lost their load of wood. Trucks that use that bridge on a daily basis, the drivers obviously do not see the 3-ton limit sign. There are too many times I've had to back up on this very narrow street, all because of a huge truck has taken up the entire road. If trucks continue to drive over this bridge, eventually the bridge will have to be replaced at the expense of the taxpayers. Any help you can give me. So there's another issue on that bridge of apparently also, Mike, I know we talked about this earlier, but what's the regulations if they attach no trucks? And I suppose there's no trucks there, they're gonna come down.
I'm gonna talk to town council about that. My understanding, if you prevent trucks from using it, you have to provide an alternate route within the town. But so
to get to those houses.
Just to get through, yeah, or to get through the town. I know that was an issue on Bridge Street that they were able to resolve because there were other ways. You could go up Main Street to North Meadows Road, but I believe you have to provide an alternate route, so that's something we need to, I need to talk to Ken and Mark about to see, you know, it's if you prevent trucks from using either the Foundry Street, the Phillips Street or the Elm Street bridges, then how do trucks get to the houses? They have to go all the way around through Walpole and come back up that way. And I'm not sure what the, on the other hand, if the bridges can't carry the weights.
I think it's important to find out how many tons that bridge would hold. There should be some kind of a sign.
There's not a sign there. When I asked Ken originally, I forget the terminology that he used, but he thought it was there was a particular code word that he had that was like an unlimited weight bridge, but I...
That just seems odd as a wooden bridge would have an unlimited weight.
I mean, I think maybe he meant the one that's at the other end of the pond, Pete, that you were talking about before, that has the stone walls on the side, that has a cast concrete box culvert.
Yeah, that was rebuilt.
And that was rebuilt, and I think that probably does have a... I mean, maybe it's not unlimited weight, but it's not a 3-ton weight limit. But the wood deck is, I think in the immediate future, I mean, I know it would be probably a longer process to come up with a design and implement a overhaul of what's there now. But I think temporary, at least, step that could be implemented would be to put figure out what a safe limit is and... Mm-hmm. And try to enforce that to keep it from getting any worse than it already is, because I'm pretty sure that it's going to get worse before it gets better anyway, at the rate it's going.
3 tons is kind of a problem because so many of the SUVs are over 3 tons.
Right.
I know that there was a tax benefit for buying a 6,000-pound plus vehicle that I looked into at one point. And
well, I think
so. You buy a Tahoe or a Suburban or.
Well, that's the loaded weight versus the curb weight. I mean, I think if the tax benefit applies, because I've done the same thing, the tax benefit applies to the weight carrying capacity, but if you have an empty SUV, it's not the same as one carrying its full load.
Okay, so hopefully we can coordinate that and make sure that bridge is not going to collapse and have an issue with that.
Okay, and I'm happy to give a tour or manipulate the water flow to allow a tour. Or
can you pick up 500-pound boulders?
I don't have that's the challenge, is that I don't think there's a way to do it without removing the deck of the bridge to be able to get in from overhead with a crane or an excavator.
Unless you with a chisel or something, break them up into pieces. I suppose that would be the other alternative, but we'll see. Okay.
Thank you, Alex, for coming in.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Hospital fevers?
We have a vote to sign 2 Chapter 90 reimbursement requests, $11,344.56 for the Green Street project and $42,039.82 for the North Meadows Pine Winter Harding Streets project, as recommended by Superintendent Feeney. And this is the Chapter 90 funds. Motion on that effect.
Second.
All those in favor?
Yep.
And we have a vote to appoint Robert Sliney to the Community Preservation Act Study Committee, as recommended by town moderator Scott McDermott.
So moved.
Mm-hmm. Second. All in favor?
Yep. So I had a...
Go ahead.
I had a conversation with someone who pointed out to me that basically, I don't know what Mr. Slaney's position is on the CPA, but basically all the people that we appointed to the CPA are CPA advocates. And I wonder if it wouldn't make sense to try to find someone who maybe hasn't already made up their mind.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right in that regard, yeah. And the other thing, too, is, as we mentioned in the last meeting, that It seemed to be dominated by historic preservation interest, and Community Preservation Act also was recreation, open space, and affordable housing. So it's probably a good idea to try to have representation from those sectors as well as people who are not necessarily in favor of it.
I believe they have gone to both the Housing Authority and the Park and Recreation Commission to try to get
volunteers,
a housing and a recreation person.
Okay, yeah. And I know the school committee appointed a special committee to look at fields. So maybe I'll ask the superintendent if they would have someone that would be interested in serving.
Coordinate there, so that their voices are heard.
Yeah. But I agree with you, Pete. I think it's a good idea to put somebody on that hasn't made up their mind.
One of the things that I've thought about in the past is that there's a huge learning curve to becoming a selectman and learning how municipal government works, and that it makes sense to me to try to take advantage of the knowledge that people acquire as a selectman, and that if we could make use of our former selectman in certain circumstances, it might be very beneficial to the town. And so I was wondering in this instance whether it might make sense to ask somebody like Ed Beard, who had been a selectman in the past, if he might be willing to serve on the Community Preservation Act Committee. He's always seemed like he's very interested.
Yeah, I think he's interested in it, particularly as an assessor too, because he would have that point of view from the people who have to raise the money too. So
he's always
he'd be a very
in
good
not
member,
spending
I think.
Yeah. Money is my sense.
Yes.
Tax money, so.
Yeah.
Or not taxing us more, so.
Would you like us to contact him and see if he's interested?
Great. Okay. Next we have discussion of sidewalk priorities.
Nice.
A couple of weeks ago we asked if the Superintendent Feeney, Superintendent Marsden, and Police Chief Meany would put together their recommendations of what they felt would be their priorities of new sidewalks. And Superintendent Feeney had Metacomet as his top priority, followed by Adam Street, connecting the north end of town to Adam Street. He had it in three phases, so that he would do Adam Street from Dale to West, phase one, and then continuing on Adam Street from West down to West Mill, and then the third phase from West Mill to Ice House Road. And then his next priority would be Dale Street, from that short section from Charlesdale to Grove, and finally, which really would be the fourth phase of the Adam Street connecting to the north end of town, Ice House Road to Copperwood. And then you would be able to have all of Harding, the north end of town, Hospital Road, have a sidewalk to get them all the way into the center of town. Chief Meany's recommendation, I believe the first was Metacomet, then second was Dale, again from Charlesdale to Grove Street, and the third was the East Main Street from Robert Sproul to, I believe that would be Shaw's area.
He actually thought, you know, he would like to see a sidewalk to
all the way to,
or at least to those two, the subdivisions up near the Dovertown line. Yeah.
And $30
million or whatever.
Yeah.
Superintendent Marsden, again, Metacomet was the top, as all three were. And again, he has Adam Street, similar. And then he has Green Street to Summer, but there is a sidewalk already there that runs on the north end of Green Street, the entire length from North Street all the way up. I know with the work they've just done, they now on the south side, they have a sidewalk that runs up as far as the swim pond now, and then eventually, I believe Ken Feeney said, would go to Lowell Mason House.
Mm.
But there is a sidewalk already.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure what he means by that. And then he had a Frary Street, and Mike, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe he's looking for roughly where it ends by Cottage Street, all the way down to Dale Street.
Correct,
that would
yes.
Connect where the apartments are in that area.
Yeah, he said that would be helpful to them in consolidating the bus stop along there. Now they have to stop at several locations
on Frary Street.
On Frary, and they'd be able to consolidate into one location to pick up the kids. Oh, okay. But they can't do that without a sidewalk, so.
Yeah, that's tricky because that's such a narrow street.
And it's a big cut, is starting to become quite a cut through in the mornings too. So.
There seems to be a lot of agreement actually between the three. So, yeah. So what's the next step? Where do we go with this now that we have recommendations?
I know Public Works is planning to do Medicomet in the spring anyway, so that's going to be done. Yeah. Ken has asked me to put an article in, and we'll get to that in a second with the draft of the Warren articles. He has been able to get agreement from a property owner on West Street to put a drainage easement in West Street. So he's going to put an article in town meeting warrant for the town to accept an easement, grant of easement, to, so he can drain the water off. That would be the upper part of Adams Street between West and West Mill.
Okay.
He believes he can do West Street between Dale, I mean Adams Street between West and Dale. He's got all the drainage in. He's got the poles are at the back of the where the sidewalk would go. So he thinks he can put that in. It's just a matter of funding it and whether he'd be able to fund that out of the Public Works budget or whether it's going to require a special article. I think we just have to
figure that out.
But certainly the Medicomet one we can do now. And then I guess I think I put an article in here. I better check and make sure I have to look at appropriating money to do a preliminary study of a sidewalk for Main Street. That's going to be a multi-year project if taking a look at that, because there's a lot of drainage issues involved. And then I'd be a little bit concerned about that bin there. Every time you put, you know, I remember that someone saying that the one of the worst accident locations in the state was a section of Route 2 where you're driving along and it's open and all of a sudden there's a lot of trees along it. And the cars psychologically push more to the middle of the road, and they had a lot of problems with head-ons. So if you put a curbing on that curve, is it going to push? And you get a lot of trucks, obviously just Tresca trucks alone going up Main Street. If they sort of, if you put a curbing there, are they going to push a little more to the center and create a potential for more accidents that already exist?
Green Street to me seems narrow.
Yeah, just things just
yes, we're talking about that.
It seems narrow.
Yeah. Well, I think initially too, because the curbs are very they're high at the moment, so it feels like
put the second coating in, and plus you got the poles and the gutter line there too, so that's another obstacle. But I think it's you're right.
The other thing that each of them mentioned is that short section on Dale Street between Charlesdale and Grove, and you got an issue of the pines out of there. You have town land that's flat and open on the other side, which is cemetery. I don't know how we look at that. But I guess my question is, who makes this decision? We have a recommendation. Is that this board needs to...
Yes, you're the
number 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, you're in charge of Public Works, and you're also technically, I believe, you're a board of survey or something. So you lay out the streets.
You want to maybe look these over, and at some point in the next couple of meetings,
yes,
you can actually come up with our priority of that.
Ken did tell me he's been working on the Dale Street one. He's been talking to see if he can get someone to cut the trees down and. You know, so
see
that
we could move the street over and leave the trees where they are.
I always remember what Barney Frank's line when they were talking about putting the central artery through Boston. Wouldn't it be cheaper just to raise the city?
Okay, Mike, you've developed. I'm sorry.
Before we leave the sidewalks, we had asked Ken, and he had agreed to get us just ballpark figures for what it would cost to run a sidewalk on Harding from Hospital up to the Dover line. Oh, just remind him that he owes us that, please.
Okay, I think...
Mike, you put together a review of potential 2016 Warren articles. Do you want to review that a little bit?
Sure. And these are the... I've just been talking to people about this. The first 10 are the revolving funds in the town election report. Article 11, the Transfer Station and Recycling Committee has asked to set up a fund to put some of the, they think if they can collect money from sale of some of the goods and that, like some of the clothing that they sell, if they could put that in a revolving fund like the other revolving funds and use it for purchase little things that they need. Collective bargaining settlement, I don't know whether Chris will have that resolved or not, but one of our unions, there's been a settlement, ongoing negotiation about 4 years now, so in case that's settled, we need to fund that. The rest on the, you get down the capital budget, I put in just a ballpark figures. I don't know, you people should decide the levels in consultation with the warrant committee as to what you want to put. I left that 50,000 that was talked about earlier for a selectman's fund.
Yeah, selectman.
And then you had asked to put money in for a capital plan.
Yeah.
And I talked to Mike LaFrancesca. He's been working on that because he worked on one when he was in Dedham. And he thinks he can get that done. He's been talking to Chris about it as well. And then you wanted funds for a townwide master plan. That's sort of a continuation of what's been ongoing with the hospital master plan. The school committee appointed a committee to study upgrading the fields at both the schools and park and rec facilities. So they asked me to reserve space, and I have no idea what a fee. I just threw a figure in there. Because of the peculiar way the bonds were bid last year, we authorized $18 million. We only borrowed $16,375,000. You have to rescind that bond authorization, and then because we had put extra money in because we thought the principal payment was going to be $900,000 for the public safety building. The way the bonds were sold or bid, the principal payments were only $820,000. So we had $80,000 left over in principal. We could not use that to pay the interest costs because the interest costs went up. So we have to appropriate money for the interest cost, and even though we had the money in hand, but we couldn't use it. And then on the solar array, we authorized $700,000. We only borrowed $610,000, so we have to rescind that bond authorization. Incidentally, all the panels are in now, and they were supposed to start the electrical work today, so they're expecting by February it should be up and running.
Excellent.
So, sewer betterment, that's a routine article, the people that pay in advance. We appropriate to a stabilization fund, then use that to reduce the sewer debt. The OPEB trust fund, I don't know, I think, there was some suggestion from the warrant committee that should be an annual thing rather than a separate article.
Yep.
It ought to be included in the health insurance budget. So I'll talk to them about that. I don't know how you people feel about putting that into the health insurance budget rather than keeping it as a separate article. If it is, yeah. It probably makes sense. Yes, yeah.
It's all right. That's okay. It's all right. It's
getting there. Yeah. And incidentally, as I mentioned, that's the one we're having the meeting, first meeting Thursday of the trust. So the South Street, West Street traffic improvements, that's the one that we had the $10,000 for the traffic study last year. And the chief suggested that the cost might be around $200,000. But he also wanted to leave it open so it could be used either for South, or he's been talking when he's been here about some of the improvements he'd like to make on West Street. So, Metacomet Park and Rec wants two articles in, one for Metacomet Park tennis court rehab, and they had a preliminary estimate about $70,000 for that, and then they want to appropriate funds for a preliminary plan estimate for Park and Rec facility. There's also an article later on for preliminary funds for an addition to the center at Medfield. So. you're going to get in that battle again.
Yes. Well, this one is it because I don't think they would know exactly where they're going to put it.
I think they prefer putting it up at the state hospital,
I know, but
MacArthur Park.
There's different plans that have been presented, whether where exactly that would be. Okay.
Sometimes these things take a few years to get resolved. So maintenance, the other two of those ones we put in every year for maintenance at the state hospital and funds for the state hospital consultant. There was some thought, Chris, I put 150. Is that reasonable, or there was?
We're going with that number now. We're doing an analysis of what we spent one-time cost versus recurring cost because we've now owned it for a year, and we'll be able to finalize that with the warrant committee.
Okay. The Pocket Park, I had an article, email from Sarah today requesting $5,500 for that, but it's not to build the park. It's for the first year maintenance of the park. Mm-hmm. And there are some issues with that I think we have to look at. But and then you people had talked about having some amount of money out of the meals tax to fund some downtown improvement projects. I just threw a figure in there. You can decide what you want to do for that.
I think the last time on the meal tax, you were up to around 120,000.
Yeah, somewhere between that range. Yeah, it's about 10,000 a month, roughly. Yeah. So then the Energy Committee wants to put one in for adopting a stretch code. They also want to talk about having some authorization to put solar panels on top of the town garage roof, and they suggested a power purchase arrangement where in effect we'd be leasing the roof for a discount on our electric rates rather than paying for it ourselves.
Is the new public safety going to go up, is that also?
That's solar ready too, and I think that the
ready.
Energy Committee is looking at that one as well.
Okay.
For the public safety building?
Yeah.
Yes, however, they think they're going to be able to do it within the budget.
And put the solar on it?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, that's what they're thinking is right now, that they can fund it, they might be able to fund it within the budget. Because
that's pretty good, you know?
Yes, they've been doing a great job, yes. Yeah, yeah.
Figured out for the buildings.
Yeah. Okay, manganese treatment facility, that's for the wells down behind the Wheelock School. And that is, we're talking about $150,000 for this year and next year. That will come out of the enterprise fund monies. I threw this one about assisted living when there was a lot of debate going on over that. I don't know whether the planning board's going to be ready to do anything on that, but I just put a space in case they wanted something. And I don't know whether there's any zoner or articles. Possibly there'd be something coming out of discussion earlier tonight about, I don't know, floor area ratios or lot size or whatever. Drainage easement on Adams Street, that's what I talked about. Ken will need to accept that. Community Preservation Act, I think the way it was explained, you have to ask the town to vote not only to put the ballot question on, but to determine the percentage, whether it's going to be 1, 2, or 3, and then whether you're going to have any exemptions. The normal one, the most common one is the 100,000 low income exemption. And a Council on Aging, as I mentioned earlier, would like, they say they have the 100,000 they have in gift funds or grant funds that will pay for the preliminary design. However, if you spend $100,000 to design a building, the likelihood is you're going to build it. I mean, otherwise you're throwing your money away. So I think when you decide that, you have to decide, are the taxpayers ready to fund an addition to that building? And I've heard costs ranging from $1.5 to $3 million for that, but I don't know. That, of course, that remains to be seen. And then I'm not sure this one's going to stay in the leash and animal control bylaws.
Oh, yeah.
I know there was a lot of discussion about whether the people walking their dogs can let them run loose and, you know, without a leash, and that other people are scared. So I don't know whether you want to get into that or not.
Isn't the chief supposed to be coming up with some sort of recommendation on that?
He is. The chief and I have been working on what other towns are doing and what our plan is.
So please, if there, I know the warrant committee asked to try to get the warrant articles in early so that they can act on them, have enough time to deliberate on them. So if you have any other articles that you would like to see or that you think somebody else might want to put in, please let me know, and I'll add them to this list. If there's anything on that list you want to knock out, again, let me know, and be glad to adjust it accordingly. I write up a lot of these warrant articles myself, so it's I'll try to get going and start writing them up. It's sort of like writing a proclamation. I can almost do it in my head.
We need a vote to open the 2016 annual town meeting warrant.
So moved.
Second. All in favor? Yep. Aye. And on January the 26th, so if anyone's interested, on January 26th, we will be voting to close that warrant. So again, if anyone has anything they want to add onto the warrant, this is the window you have right now. And we have Selectman reports.
Just one additional point on that. I know earlier we said for special it takes 200 registered voters to call a special and 100 to put an article in, but for the annual, it's only 10 registered voters can put an article on the town meeting warrant, so it's very different for the annual than it is for special. So.
Yeah, so I want to thank everyone. I've been volunteering like I do every year with Lions, you know, for the Christmas tree sales up at in Shaw's at the front parking lot. So we're all sold out last Sunday afternoon. So I think it's it's pretty early. I think it's almost the earliest that we've done it in years.
You had great weather.
Yeah, I think that was the big deal. Yeah, it was nice and stuff. We weren't standing out in the rain trying to sell Christmas trees. So we've had some great. So we do appreciate everyone. Lions Club appreciates everyone in Medfield for their support. It's a big fundraiser for the club. We really count on it so that we can use the funds on an annual basis. So it's great. The trees are fabulous. We get them from Maine now, and we had switched. Not origins, but the guy that supplies the trees, and I think they're just really, really nice trees. So once again, thanks everyone for that. And holiday season, really in the last couple of weeks, full swing, right? We had the tree lighting on Friday, December 4th, with the Joy to the World, with the young kids up there singing and stuff. It was another nice, mild night. Pretty much you could almost wear shorts, you know, I mean, go to that. So it was great, and it was a tremendous crowd. And I thought too, with the I think the postcards that went out to do the holiday stroll, yeah, whatever it's called, I think that Gene had sent out, I think, in the group, that was very nice because it was packed. Because I left a little early to get home, and there's a big traffic jam in town. So it was really, really good to see that. So I thought that was really
good. I think that's going to be a great tradition. It really is.
Yeah, I think this worked out good.
There were so many people walking around the downtown, which is really what you want.
You want to see. Yeah, it was excellent. And I'm sorry I missed the Christmas parade. I had a family commitment in Whitman. But you guys can still hear. You didn't lose your hearing. I heard you were in front of the fire truck.
Yeah. We were in front of the fire truck.
Yeah.
Last year we walked behind, we got the exhaust. So this year we said we walk in front.
Yeah, there you go.
The siren. So.
So next year we'll figure it out.
Yeah. Right on top of the truck.
Something. Yeah. But it was a beautiful day once again, right?
It was gorgeous.
60 degrees.
Yep. So it's unbelievable for everyone turning out and stuff. And then just a memo, had their holiday party this last week, which was great. And then just another little note to Colleen Sullivan had a nice Friday down at the Medfield TV, had a showing for her photography, things up on the wall, really, really nice stuff. And most of them were sold, that I could see. Anyways, they had sold signs on most of them. So Colleen does wonderful, takes wonderful photographs, so it was nice. And once again, another good thing, they're trying to get the feel for another place in Medfield where you can use it for events, right, and get people to come and get together and chit-chat and do something. So it was good, a lot of good things going on during the holiday season. So that's it for me.
Great, thank you. Pete?
So the main thing that I want to let you know about is the Energy Committee had a fellow in from an outfit called Good Energy to talk about energy aggregation. And the concept of it basically is that towns are permitted to aggregate together with other towns to offer their residents the opportunity to buy energy through this group. And you do it so that you can provide less expensive energy to the residents in town, basically. Let's see. Good Energy said they're looking to aggregate like 230,000 accounts, 130 towns. So you get a lot of buying power, I guess, is the idea when you have everybody doing it together. And also you get there, an outfit like this, like Good Energy, acts as your consultant. And so they're basically contracting for a rate that I think goes out for 2 years. But you have to be careful because these rates are going up and down and sometimes get stuck with high rates. I think the individual homeowner can actually opt out at any point. So if the rate goes high, they can opt out. But then, you know, you're back at whatever the Eversource rate is or whatever the other supplier is. It sounded like a good idea to me. I had heard a presentation about it before and brought it back to the selectmen. The Energy Committee doesn't think it's really in their bailiwick because it's not so much saving money for the town or saving energy for the town. It's saving money and energy for the individual homeowners. And so they thought that maybe if anything was going to happen, that it should come from the selectmen instead. So, but if the selectmen are interested in getting involved, we would just...
Did they know of any other towns in the area that are considering this in this immediate area? I know, I think in the southeastern part of the state, there's about 21 cities and towns that are...
Fall River, your town, and New Bedford, and I mean, it's a lot of towns. I don't remember the names of all of the towns, but did I write down any of them? No, I didn't write down any.
But it would be, if we were going to aggregate, that might be something that Regionalization Committee might want to take a look at
it's project. It's a farm. Of 130 towns.
Would you be able to get some of that over to Gus Murphy to see if he wants to follow up on that, or just even an email to the board?
Sure.
Sure.
Yeah.
That's a good suggestion.
Yep. Okay. And that's it.
I have several things. One, just driving around town. It's now that we're in the winter season. It's dark around 4:30. I've just been noticing an awful lot of our street lights that are out. So I actually met with the chief, and we came up, I'm calling it Lights On program, but what the chief is doing is he's going to instruct the two shifts, the late afternoon and the night shift, every time they go out, they're to come back with at least a couple of street lights that are out. And using one of the sergeants that will record that, Eversource has a number you can call, and they log in, and then they'll come out and they'll actually fix that light. Because right now, we pay a fee, whether that light is on or off, we're paying for that for the whole year. And just driving around, I've seen at least 20 of those lights that are out. So what the chief is now doing, and he said last Friday they recorded 9, and Monday 9 more, so that's 18. And they'll record that. And there's also a website, and maybe we can put it on our website. I think we might have actually done that before, but I couldn't find it. But there is a web site that Eversource has that the average citizen can go in. So if anybody sees a light out, they can just go to the website and they fill the information in, and that gets recorded as well. And it's for the benefit of their own neighborhood that these lights are out.
Chris, I think that was on that the rider I gave that came with the bills last month.
Say again?
There was a... an envelope stuffer in your electric bill last month, and it had that number and on it. So I've given it to Chris to okay. She's trying to put together something that will go on the website, or who you call for. You know, snow days for schools, trash, transfer station hours, all those things, and so that have it on the website so that people that need to, and that information can just go right there.
That would be a good one to add then. Just some past issue that in 1980, when Proposition 2.5 came in, we took out about a third of all the streetlights in town. So the streetlights that are left are there for safety reasons. They're on bad curves, intersection, high traveled streets. So when that light is out, it also becomes a safety issue in my mind. So I just commend the chief for following up and thanking him on that. I met with, I had a phone call from Robert Parga, the principal at the Medfield High School, that he had a number of high school seniors that are in the environmental science class that were very concerned and wanted to do more with solar at the high school. And I was able to get Andrew Seaman, our facilities manager, along with Fred Bunger and Marie Zach Nolan from the Energy Committee, and we sat down and met with those students. And they really want to look at, and they're going to meet with the superintendent to put the solar over the, their first idea was to put the solar over the parking lot.
Right.
Which I think I showed you pictures before at Falmouth High School rink and also over by Shoppers World.
Yeah, REI
does it. Does it as well. So they're going to follow up on that.
Superintendent didn't want it. So it's not going to happen.
Nice when
it's well, the complaint yes, was yes. that the visual yeah. of it didn't like it, but they were going to pursue. And the other area is that they really felt it was important for Medfield to become a green community, and they wanted to pursue that as well. So I thought that was interesting. I went to the retirement party of Friends of the Library. Kathleen Brennan was there for 15, 16 years, has done just a tremendous job. I also went to
wasn't
the...
Wasn't that a wonderful set of remarks that she
it
had?
It was.
Yes, yeah.
It was so well crafted.
Yeah. She did a very nice job on that. And she'll be missed, and they just do a tremendous job of filling in the pluses that make our library. And I was talking to someone from Medway who said, their friends of the library, their money all goes for the books. The town appropriates zero. So I think we're very fortunate to have the staff and the friends of the library and the physical facility we have.
It's $20,000 a year that they've been raising, and it goes to the programs and the museum passes and all those extra things.
Yeah. I went to the 90th birthday celebration of former selectman and longtime town firefighter, civil defense director, you name it, Buck Buchanan, and read the proclamation from this board, which he appreciated. And again, Mark mentioned the whole thing of the Christmas parade and the stroll, which just was tremendous. I also took part in, you mentioned the Lions Club. They also do a great job running the speech contest every year as one of the judges for that. And I received an email, and Mike, maybe we can send this to Ken and Eddie Hinckley. This is from a Sue Turner on 94 High Street. And she's asking if the tree warden could examine. She says there's a large branch on a tree that overhangs Route 27 at 94 High Street to the right of the driveway as you face the driveway. She said, I asked the tree warden to examine it several years ago without response. The other issue with the tree and traffic signs on that side of the driveway is that it makes it very difficult to see oncoming traffic when you pull out of the driveway unless you're almost onto the street.
Do you know about where that is on
94, I think it's just opposite Forest Street and near where the town right-of-way goes into the town wells.
It's just on the Walpole side of that town right-of-way.
Oh, okay, good.
And I'll give you that email.
Yeah,
it's got all the...
You can follow up.
Oh, okay,
if they
good.
Want to meet yeah. something, I'd be glad to sit in on that.
Okay.
And the other thing I wanted to point out, because we're in December now, my term of office is up in March, and I have decided I'm not going to run for re-election on that, and I wanted to be able to give residents, hopefully, time. I believe they have until early February to take out papers. They could have taken the first papers out, I believe, starting December 1. Just a little bit of my philosophy, I just kind of view elected officials as kind of citizen public servants. In that sense, and to steal a little bit from James K. Polk, and someone said to me, if I had a nickel for every time I heard a James K. Polk quote, I'd have a nickel. but James K. Polk had four goals, he said, when he ran for president, he accomplished those and did not run for re-election. When I ran, the reason I ran for selectmen, I had a number of goals. One was the issue of communication and neighborhood concerns. Mm-hmm. And through the walks and the blog and mini town halls and other things, I felt we've made a lot of improvement with that. I had concerns with the downtown. I think we've made a lot of progress with our downtown in the past 3 years. I also wanted to do more with long-range planning. I think we've done a lot with that, with the master plan, with the individual departments that now come in with their long-range goals, as well as the long-range budgets, and now we're also looking at capital improvements. Again, a commitment to educational excellence and also providing town citizens with excellent services. And I think if you look at the new DPW garage, new public safety, the purchase of the state hospital property, I think we're heading towards that. I really wanted to revitalize the Economic Development Committee that had not met for over 5 years. I think they're off to a good start. They've surveyed the businesses. They're going to have the summit now in February. They've made recommendations and worked on lot number three. I also want to deal with the issues of traffic. The chief, I think, has done a good job in this. We've now rewired the lights. I think coming out of South Street and 109, even though it's the second busiest undivided highway, we're moving traffic through that area. And last town meeting, we did appropriate money for a traffic study. And hopefully, we'll look at the issue of South Street and Route 27. And finally, a plan for the future of Medfield State Hospital. We have purchased that, and we have a very active committee that I think is making a lot of progress and is going to come back with some recommendations on that. Myself, I certainly will continue to be very active and involved. And if there are areas in the future on, you know, local state issues, I certainly will be there to, you know, make a voice and offer my services on that. I don't believe in the term lame duck. I have a couple more months and will continue to be as active as I can until the end of March on that. This board is just, I feel, very stable. The longevity of the two selectmen and the other people that are here give a lot of stability and knowledge to this board. Hopefully, I'd like to be nice to someone with new ideas, a younger person, female, a little diversity, maybe that wants to run for the board, maybe can come in. And I think the people have until February to get to the town clerk and turn those papers in. So. I'm not gone yet, but I just want to give time for people to take out papers. Yeah, but anyhow, so that's my news.
Richard, thank you for your service as a selectman.
You're welcome.
Very
welcome.
Very helpful to the town.
Again, I'm not gone yet, but I also want to announce because we are right at the Christmas season, a couple of things that people will be interested in, and that is the idea of the transfer station. We're going to be open the 23rd, which is Wednesday,
yeah.
And then the 24th, the day before Christmas, and then we'll be closed Christmas Day, the 25th, but we'll be open on Saturday, the 26th. So Wednesday and Thursday before Christmas and Saturday after, and the same thing will hold true for New Year's Day. It'll be open Wednesday, the 30th, Thursday, the 31st, and then the day after New Year's on the 2nd. And wishing everybody happy holidays. We'll be back on the first of the year. And any other business to come before the board?
No.
Okay.
Excellent.
Motion to adjourn.
So move.
Thank you.
The preceding was a production of Medfield TV.